AI is one of the most important things humanity is working on. It's more profound than, I don't know, electricity or fire. So my point is, we have to be concerned about it.
Yeah, you probably already guessed it. Today's video is going to be about artificial intelligence, which can be really difficult. And I've sort of didn't want to make this video because everyone seems to be using artificial intelligence as an excuse. Well, we don't need to learn anything because artificial intelligence will be able to do everything better than us in the future, which might be true in some cases, but it's definitely not the case right now. If you look at machine learning, which is an aspect of artificial intelligence, then it requires a lot of data and it requires a lot of processing power. It's just not the most efficient solution if you have a linear problem. What I mean by this is from TensorFlow. They have a great website where you can experiment with artificial intelligence and machine learning in general. They have this playground place where you can try actual problems. And if we take this problem, for instance, we have this square where there's two different colored dots in the middle, and depending on how you arrange the dots, you sort of create different problems for the artificial intelligence. And if you are able to split the dots into two different categories by a single line, then we call it a linear problem. The more complicated the structures, the harder it is for the machine, and the more processing power and the more hidden layers you need. See, you can't solve a nonlinear problem without hidden layers. That's where we have this machine learning algorithm that builds these neural networks. They can have as many hidden layers as we want, but it's not always ideal to have many hidden layers because it will add to the amount of processing power it takes to train the algorithm. So in this example, for instance, we have a checkered set of pieces, which is a nonlinear problem. We have to use at least two lines to solve this. So you need to have at least one hidden layer, but apart from that, you can kind of experiment with what works best. It is definitely possible to get this split up even if you don't have an ideal solution. When it comes to a more complex problem like this, the spiral, the infamous spiral on TensorFlow, it's difficult. This is the solution that I came up with by Googling. It's really that simple. And yeah, it is possible to do it even on a pretty bad computer and get really good results. But this kind of shows how you don't need to use a machine learning algorithm to solve every problem in the world. With that being said, keep in mind that there are still different kinds of neural networks and different ways to set these machines up. When people want output right now, they usually use what's called a GAN method, G-A-N. Basically having two different machines inside the program that fights against each other. One of them is trying to cheat the other, and when it succeeds, the output in the other end is completely generated by an artificial intelligence. That's how people make some of these outputs. But without further ado, enjoy.
It's widely accepted that millions of jobs are going to disappear. And in this future, the robots and algorithms that will replace us could either reduce us to poverty or set us free.
I think we might well experience a new renaissance of creativity and of social interaction in a very positive way. If people have the leisure to do whatever they want to do, they will be more fulfilled because they'll be doing the things that interest them.
It may sound a long way away. After all, at the moment, robots only do one thing at a time. But what if one can do all the things that we can?
It's expected that within about a generation from now, a machine will be built which is better than a human. And that changes everything.
According to the Korea Employment Information Service, AI-powered robots will be able to replace 29.1% of the local job market. They were also competent enough to replace 70% of the duties performed by doctors, 59.3% of university professors' duties, and 48.1% of duties done by lawyers in Korea. In terms of memory formation, physical tenacity, sight, hearing, and spatial skills, artificial intelligence is incomparably better than the human workforce. Humans perform better in tasks measuring creativity and in persuasive or negotiating situations.
Help us understand what machine learning is, because that seems to be the key driver of so much of the excitement and also the concern around artificial intelligence. How does machine learning work?
Today, we have reached a scale of computing and data sets that was necessary to make machines smart. So here's how it works. If you program a computer today, say your phone, then you hire software engineers that write a very, very long kitchen recipe. Like, if the water is too hot, turn down the temperature. The new thing now is that computers can find their own rules. So instead of an expert deciphering step by step a rule for every contingency, what you do now is you give the computer examples and have it influence its own rules. That is exciting because it relieves the software engineer of the need of being super smart.
Here's an idea. The question is not whether computers and artificial intelligence can make art. The question is whether we will allow them to make art.
Engineers and artists alike are experimenting with artificial intelligence to see what kind of imagery, stories, poetry, and music machines can generate. For this track called Daddy's Car, engineers at Sony's Computer Science Laboratory developed an AI called Flow Machines to create music in the style of the Beatles. After feeding sheet music into the algorithm to teach the AI, machines generated the melody and harmony. AI is becoming part of the toolbox for designers and filmmakers as well. Adobe's Wet Brush, for example, uses algorithms that simulate brush strokes and the way liquid paint is distributed by different painting techniques.
We've wondered whether the fundamentally human-seeming endeavor of art making can be done by machines. I say yes, absolutely, it can.
My name's Doug. I'm going to talk to you about Magenta, a project that we're doing in Google Brain that's focused on music and art with machine learning. So I want to point out, for those of you that are paying attention to deep learning in some sense is not new. We've had neural networks since at least the 1980s, but they haven't always shown themselves to be the best models for the job. One explanation for this is that neural networks are really good at scale. They're really good when you have a lot of data or when you have large models. And so as we move with more compute power, what we find is that neural networks end up winning out over other technologies. This project is about teaching a machine learning model to learn to draw. And these are some of the pictures that this machine learning model drew. The input are stroke-based drawings done by people when they play the game, Quick Draw. And we encode them using a recurrent neural network that is actually moving through the sequence of strokes, trying to predict the next stroke. It's called a bidirectional recurrent neural network, or a bidirectional LSTM. And the whole job of that network is to create this vector that's going to be used to condition the decoding. So we have this embedding, this number, the string of numbers in latent space that we can sample from, that we can add some noise to and generate new instances of data that will then be driven through the decoder, which is in this case another recurrent neural network, though only going in one direction from left to right. It's going to drive a mixture of Gaussians, so a mixture of possible places where the pen would land next. What I'm going to do is I'm going to draw something, and then we're going to sample from the model 9 times. And remember, the model has some noise in it. It's not completely deterministic, so we're going to get 9 different drawings. And so let's take and just draw a raindrop. All right? You'll see my raindrop appearing 9 times, and I did a nice big round raindrop, and now I'm going to let the model go, and it's going to make rain happen. You could also just say, hey, let's draw rain like this, because some people draw rain like this. And notice the model kind of follows my lead, and it draws rain like I did. If you draw a cloud, right? In your mind's eye, what's going to happen when I let that cloud go? It's going to rain, right? I just think that's so cool. I actually don't know how to draw a cruise ship. I've never actually been on a cruise ship, I don't think. So I'll just do that, and then QuickDraw will fill it in with different kinds of cruise ships, or sketch RNN based on QuickDraw. Let's look back at the paper from last year called WaveNet. It's trying to learn to generate audio from audio. It's actually learning on the raw PCM, pulse code modulation, sampled 16,000 times a second, and it's trying to predict the next sample conditioned on about the last 2 seconds of samples. And what it uses is something called dilated convolution. So you see the arrows, they get spread further and further apart. It's almost like they're being dilated in time, so that the next prediction is conditioned not only on the sample that came last, but some samples or some representations of samples that happened further and further in the past. Let's play Dizzy, please. The model's learning to train on Dizzy Gillespie only and get something out of it. Let's play Metallica. So what we see is that the NSYNC data trained on WaveNet alone does some cool things, but it doesn't give us what our desired goal, which is to have kind of coherent musical notes. So what we decided to do was add an autoencoder to WaveNet so that we can constrain and help it understand how sound is unfolding in time. This basic diagram should look familiar. You have some input. Now it's not a cat. It's an input waveform. We're going to encode that in time using a kind of convolutional model. It's not a WaveNet, but is also using deep dilated convolutions. That's going to give us some sort of embedding. And in this case, the embedding actually unfolds in time. So it's 16 values that change every few milliseconds. And then we're going to have a WaveNet decoder, the same WaveNet that we just saw. And the WaveNet is actually going to have the input audio available when it's training, but it's also going to see this conditioning information from our Zed. And if it wants to take advantage of it, it can. And in fact, it does to great effect. So now what we can do is encode an entire note and we can then decode from it. Let's listen to the original bass. Now, if we run that bass through our model and decode it, in the same way that we ran the cat through our model and looked at the cat, it sounds like the bass on the bottom. It's a little bit distorted, but more or less it captures the sound of the bass. So now you're asking, why would you want to reconstruct noisy versions of these samples? Because we're living in this embedding space, we can do exactly what we did with the images of the cats. We can move between sounds we know and listen to what the model does in spaces that we don't know. So let's listen to what bass and flute sounds like original. It sounds like a bass and a flute, right? You just average the signals together. Now let's listen to bass and flute from nSynth. What it does in my mind's eye is makes a really big bass flute, right?
So we're at Stanford right now. Our first class starts here. I'm going to try and talk to the teacher afterwards.
We have some really optimistic statements from Elon Musk and the CEO of Uber that says it's going to be in the next 2 to 5 years.
Do you think that's even possible?
Well, the main thing is getting the LiDAR and the vision. There's a debate whether you need LiDAR, which is more of a fine-tuned sensor or camera. You can just do it on cameras. Tesla, I think cameras are sufficient.
Tesla says that they have to do it with cameras, otherwise it will be too heavy computer power.
But then the other debate is it going to be accurate enough? Manufacturers just won't use the cameras. They want LiDAR. That's my understanding.
It's interesting that that's the approach you took, because I actually thought you would be skeptic because of the regulations.
I think it's a bit like, you know, when you live in Silicon Valley, you may start off lean startup model and say, okay, we're not going to do the whole of the US, we're not even going to do the whole of San Francisco, we'll do my driveway. We'll do my senior home center. There are ways to get around to do simpler, smaller examples.
Can I get you to like give it a year? Do you think it's kind of 10 years, 15, 2 years?
It's more like 4 or 5 years.
5 years?
Yeah, 5 years. I don't know, 2 years seems, you'll get demonstrations, but the trick is, can you actually buy one?
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Is that okay?
Yeah, that was perfect.
That is it. I really hope you guys liked this video. As you can see, artificial intelligence can be used to make art, and they can make art on their own. I found this super interesting when I first heard about it. It was this 18-year-old speaker named Robbie Barat who came to the lecture, and I mean, he's done crazy stuff. He's insane. But yeah, very, very impressive. If you're new to the channel, then don't forget to subscribe. I really do put in a lot of effort into these videos, especially this one. I've been super stoked to share it with you guys. I'm a little sorry that the audio is so bad on the lecture. That is just kind of how it has to be when you're in a huge hall with a lot of people. I'm very sorry. I put on subtitles. I hope that helped. But yeah, I'll see you guys next week. Take care.